Well, then, friends, let us prepare our hearts to worship God.
Please join me in the call to worship, which you can find printed in your bulletin, reading responsibly. We've come to worship God.
Who loved us before we were even born.
We've come to worship God.
Who knows us even better than we know ourselves.
We've come to worship God.
Whose presence never leaves us, and whose love for us never ceases.
This is our God.
Let us worship together.
Let us pray. All-knowing God, we gather together with praise and thanksgiving for who you are and for all that you have done for us. You know us better than we know ourselves, all our thoughts and actions, and yet you love us still. Move in our hearts and minds as we worship together and guide us to paths that lead to life. For we are your people, called by your name. Amen.
God of grace.
morning that we might add our voices to that global chorus who raises our praises to our God of great and God of small. But friends, if we come here and we hear the words, if we come here and we sing our songs, if we come here and we listen to your word proclaimed, but we do not confess our sins, then we lie to ourselves, we lie to each other, we lie to our God, and the truth, it isn't in us. But our God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us every sin and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. It is with faith, therefore, that we turn our hearts to God in prayer, first using our printed prayer of confession that you will find in your bulletins, and then in a time of silence. Friends, let us pray. God, you have promised that you are always there, but we forget. We wonder where you are and forget that you are always with us. We convince ourselves there is some place we can go in the world where you aren't. We tell ourselves that we can do something that would cause you to stop loving us. We tell ourselves that other people can fall out of your grace. Forgive us. Call us back. Gather us in. Turn us around to walk in your way, loving God. Amen. Friends, hear and believe the good news. Who is it who is in a position to condemn? Who is it who stands in a place where they can judge? It is only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, and a new life has begun. Friends, know that we indeed are forgiven, and be at peace.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds this morning by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may hear your word with joy and respond with courage and faith. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. This morning's first scripture reading is from the book Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 25 to 30, and can be found on page 12 of the New Testament in your pew Bibles. Listen for God's holy word. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I'd like to invite our young disciples to come down
for a little time together. Good morning, guys. How are you this morning?
Good.
How's your summer going? Are you super ready to go back to school? Yeah, we've got some hard no's here. It's a good thing you've still got a couple of weeks to get your heads wrapped around that, don't you? Well, this morning I had thought of a book I wanted to share with you. And I don't know if you are aware, but sometimes when you move, things get put in different places, and I don't have any idea what happened to this book, so we're going to have to get a new copy of it. But do you know the book called The Runaway Bunny?
No.
Oh, you have heard this book before, young man. But it's about a bunny who decided that this bunny was going to run away. Do you ever know anyone who's threatened to run away from home? Oh, this bunny said, you know what? I am going to run away from home. And everywhere that bunny thought to run, that bunny's mama was there. So that bunny said, I am going to run away and become a bird and fly away on my own. And there's the little bunny flying away. And guess what the mama told him she would become?
A tree.
Mama said, I'll be the tree that you come home to. So the little bunny decided, well, I'll try something else. I'll become a flower in the garden. It's hard to see, but there's that bunny as a crocus in the garden. You see the bunny right there? And what did the mama say she would become if that little bunny became a crocus? A gardener. You're exactly right. Mama said, I'll become a gardener and I will come tend to you. Well, then I'll be a fish, that little bunny said. Do you see the bunny is a fish in the stream? And I'll swim, swim, swim as far as I can go. Well, what did Mama Bunny say then?
I'll be a fisherman.
Very good. And I'll bring my pole and I'll catch you and bring you home. Well, maybe then I'll become a sailboat. Do you see the bunny's ears, the sails? And I'll sail as far away as I can. And what did Mama Bunny say then?
Will be the wind.
Yes, very good. She said, I'll be the wind and I will always blow you to a safe harbor. That little bunny was going to go and find all sorts of places to hide, but that mama bunny was always going to find her little bunny. The psalm that we're going to read this morning is a psalm that God promises that exact same thing to us. That wherever we go, wherever we run, it doesn't matter. God is going to be there and make sure that we are not alone and that we know that we are loved. So I want you guys each to pick which one of these pictures you like the most. Oh, you want the flower garden one? I think that's an excellent choice. Which one do you want? Oh, I like the bird one too. And you keep these pictures for this week, and the words on that little, for that section are on the back of it too. To remember that just like that mama bunny, we have a God who loves us and will always come after us. And that's some pretty good news, isn't it? Can we say a prayer together? Dear God, we thank you that when we are like a runaway bunny, you are always there and are always a safe place where we can run and hide. Remind us that your love for us will go wherever we do. Amen. Thanks, guys. Amen and amen. Our second scripture reading today comes from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 12. Listen this morning for God's word to you. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my paths and my lying down and are acquainted with all of my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle to the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the night wraps itself around me, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. After a church service one day, a minister came up to a woman in the congregation. I noticed your husband walked out in the middle of the service. I hope I didn't say anything that offended him. Oh, you don't have to worry, the wife said. He's been walking in his sleep for years. Well, hope neither of those happened this morning. Today we begin a 5-week series that seemed appropriate for us this time of year because its goal is for us to chill out. I wish I could tell you that it would bring cooler temperatures in, but hopefully this journey through some of the wisdom we find in the Psalms will help us to chill out in some other ways. And maybe we'll remember there are always popsicles in the freezer when the temperatures get too much. As opposed to a few weeks ago when Abraham and Isaac took a long walk up a mountain to be a sacrifice, I can wholeheartedly return to the claim today that this really is one of my favorite psalms that we ever read. I can even say that today when our reading stops before we get to the line where we are reminded that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. For the most part, the text we read in our Old Testament remind us that this faith thing that we do is a corporate activity. Faith in the Old Testament communities was about doing our faith, living our faith together as a community. There was very little understanding of this sense of individuality that is so important to us today. The law of Moses is all about how it is we live in community. The prophets came to challenge when we were not living up to how we should behave as a community of faith. All of it is corporate. All of it is us together as a people until we get to the Psalms, and there we find some of the most beautiful instances of individuality within our faith. So many of the Psalms are deeply personal. The Lord is my shepherd. I will lift my eyes up to the hills. From whence shall my help come? Psalm 139 that we read this morning is intensely personal, an intimate confession of a person whose lifelong relationship with God was a result of persistence, of God's search and pursuit, and eventually finding that individual again. As many of you know, Jeff and the boys and I returned on Friday from a week at Lake Travis outside of Austin, Texas. This summer marked the 49th gathering of this family in this place, a gathering that started in a single condo and now has spread to at least four as the family continues to grow. It's hard to point to any one moment of our annual lake trip that is our favorite, though Jordan and Daniel and the other grandkids might point to Granny Night, where there is a birthday party with presents and cake to celebrate everyone all year long. Don't tell them, but that's also our generation's favorite nights, because the grannies take the kids and we get to have a dinner that is just adults. It's wonderful as well. But in reality, it's the time spent with family that make this trip so very special. It was a week ago this very morning that Jeff's dad, John, a retired Presbyterian pastor himself, sat on the back porch with me and asked what my sermon was going to be this Sunday when I returned. And so we sat with our coffee overlooking the lake, talking about this text. And John commented that the Psalms are a constant reminder to us of the lessons that God wants us to hear. And as I walked through that week together, I discovered that, as usual, John was right. And all week long, I saw the words of the 139th Psalm lived out in front of us. Being seen and being known is important. Betty and Lucy, two of the boys' cousins, were dismayed to discover that the youngest of the cousins simply referred to them as Daniel Kahn's sister, instead of knowing that they had names on their own. With the righteous indignation that is oh so natural to teenagers, hands on hips, Lucy declared, "We deserve to be known. O Lord, you have searched me, and you know me." While he was imprisoned for his resistance against the Nazis, German pastor Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote a poem called "Who Am I?" in which he meditates upon the differences between what other people say about who he is and what he believed himself. Others often saw him as a cheerful tower of strength and faith among hardship. But inside, he felt restless, yearning, even weak, a tiny bird in a cage, barely alive. "Who am I?" he writes, "this man or the other? Am I then this man today and tomorrow another? Am I both all at once an impostor to others, but to me little more than a whining, despicable weakling? They mock me, these lonely questions of mine." But Bonhoeffer concludes this poem with a type of Psalm 139. "Whoever I am, you know me, O God. You know that I am yours." How wonderful it is that even when we do not know ourselves, to be searched and to be known by God. How wonderful, but also maybe how fearful it is to be searched and to be known by God. The psalmist gets this too. This language that we hear, "you hem me in," behind and before. The Hebrew word there for him doesn't mean an evening cuddle before one goes to bed. It doesn't refer to a protective embrace, a great bear hug, or even being bubble wrapped for your protection. The word for him in is the same word that we see when a city is laid under siege. You besiege me, O God. You hem me in. You entrap me. You encircle me. You never leave me alone. The truth is, we don't always want to be known through and through by anyone. We want to maintain a strict control over who knows what about us and when they learn what they know. We want to be in charge of our own secrets. Come and see a man, the Samaritan woman proclaimed, who told me everything I had ever done. And not many people took her up on that offer. Jesus could look at a person and would stare in their eyes, knowing who they were, even those parts they most wanted to keep hidden. And if we're honest, that makes us uncomfortable. If we're honest, we're not sure it's something we really want. Oh God, you have searched me and you know me. You know my name. You know my secrets. You know my everything. And even when it makes me uncomfortable, you still are there. Cousin Jack, though, Jack had a different 139th Psalm experience this week at the lake. Except for a short time the first weekend when Travis and his wife Caitlin joined us, Jack was the oldest of the youngest generation of cousins, which made him the target of the youngest cousin's attention. He could not sit down without having little legs crawling into his lap or crawling behind him and sitting on his shoulders. One afternoon, he escaped to his room for a nap, quietly and quickly locking that door behind him in hopes of gaining a few moments of solitude. He might have wanted to ask many times during this week, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" I'll confess that that line has always been a challenging one for me to hear. For those who have been and have experienced unhealthy relationships in their past, this language can sound threatening, even like harassment. So if that is you, be gentle with yourself and know that it is okay to bristle at this because you aren't bristling at God's word, but instead at the memories that it recalls. But it is a statement that sounds so very different depending on the context in which it is spoken. The movie Playing by Heart came out when I was in college, and I will be honest, I can't count how many weekends we spent with that movie running on the admittedly VHS player that was in my dorm room. It starts off telling what seem like the stories of completely unrelated people, but as the movie goes on, it becomes clear that these love stories are more connected than they might first have appeared. It also comes with a cast that will stop any 90 kid's heart with happiness. In one scene, Keenan stands before his girlfriend Joan and asks, "What did I ever do to deserve you?" With a wry smile, Joan, played by Angelina Jolie, answers, "You know, usually that line is screamed at me by someone running out the door. not said by someone standing before me and planning to stay. It makes for a nice change. It may well be the case that in your life, someone might have said to you, there is nowhere you can go to get away from me, nowhere that my presence doesn't reach you, and it sounded like a threat. Instead, when God says that to us, it is a promise. Where can I go to get away from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If your days are full of job or full of family or full of complicated relationship, full of demands on your time, listen for the promise that comes in these ancient words. You know when I'm going to sit and when I'm going to stand. You know my thoughts, even when they are far away. The next time you are hurrying to catch a plane, maybe on a busy day of travel, coming home, fighting crowds and escalators and ticket counters, and fall into your seat, remember these ancient promises. If I ascend to the heavens, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning, you are there. Even there, your hand will hold me fast. And if your life can only be described as something hellish, if nothing is working, if all seems tragically empty and lonely, if relationships are sour and work is boring and there is no light on the horizon, no promise, no hope, remember these words. If I make my bed in Sheol, another word for hell, you are there. Oh God, you have searched me and you know me. And even so, you stick with me so closely that it seems you will never let me go. One of my favorite television shows used to be Bravo's Inside the Actor's Studio. On this show, James Lipton would interview actors, usually individually, but occasionally a whole cast of a television show or a movie. At the end of the hour-long interview, Lipton posed the same 10 questions each time to his guest, a practice originated in French television by Bernard Pivot. After asking what their favorite word was and their least favorite word, the sound or noises that they love or that they hate, other professions they might like to try or ones they would avoid, their favorite curse word, which was always fun to hear, Lipton would close each episode with this: if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates? The great Anthony Quinn was on Lipton's show when he was an old man. And when he was asked that question, he paused for a moment, and then slowly, and you can imagine God speaking in Anthony Quinn's voice, I want to hear, Tony, I understand. Friends, there is no hiding from God. God has known us since time began and will know us throughout all of eternity. And even though God knows every inmost thought we have, God loves us still. God delights in who we are, not naive to the good and the bad that comes through our lives. How wonderful it is to be known by God. And indeed, sometimes how fearful. Oh Lord, you have searched me and you know me. And yet you love me still. For that, friends, thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me in saying that which we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed, which you'll find printed in the bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let us give to God as we have received, as the ushers take up the morning offering. Thank you. us pray. We offer our gifts to you, Lord, with grateful, cheerful hearts. Thank you that you meet our needs on the journey, providing what we need when we need it. Trusting you, we can share what we have with others. And we do this joyfully, together, today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Friends, will you join your hearts with me in prayer? Gracious God, we have so much for which to thank you. For our lives, our talents, our families, our friends, but especially your coming to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. As we bring you our thanks, we recall the wonder of this world and of your creation, of you making us in your image. We thank you, too, that through the centuries you have not only been patient with us, but even sent your Son to bring us back to you. In his living and dying, he showed us the greatness of service, the strength of weakness, and the power of love. Even then, Lord, you have not left us alone, for you have sent us your Holy Spirit to strengthen and inspire us. For all these acts of grace and of love, we offer our heartfelt thanks. God, we turn our hearts to the needs of your world, needs that are great, needs that are known to us sometimes and sometimes known only to you. As we pray for your world, we thank you that you value each and every one of us, that all are important in your eyes with none less or more so. And so we pray especially this morning for all who have lost that sense of perspective. We pray for those who have fallen into the error of pride and ask that you would help them to recognize their own weaknesses as well as their strengths. And we lift up to you those who feel themselves to be worthless, unimportant, unvalued, unloved. Grant them the assurance that whatever their circumstance, they are precious to you. Give us all a proper sense of our value, a true appreciation of the worth of others, and above all, an understanding of your greatness, beside which we are nothing, and yet through which we count as your children. Lord, we pray all these things and so many more in the strong name of Jesus, who taught his disciples when gathered together to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. friends, we go from this place today with a promise that is sure, that we worship a God who indeed will abide with us always. Remember that each and every moment of the week that comes before you. Sometimes it is an easy thing to forget, but we are not sent from here to do this work alone. We go instead like we do each week, knowing that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit all are with us today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.